also yesterday commended Modi ji on the way we are handling this situation.
To mitigate the effect of coronavirus, to mitigate the spread of coronavirus, the lockdown declared and then the extension was very timely, and we take pride in saying that we have been, so far we have succeeded in flattening the curve, and we hope that India would be remembered in times to come as one country which took very prompt action and which handled this COVID-19 issue very well. Sir, the international trade, if I talk about it, even before this pro-COVID, the trade was getting a lot of issues because of the trade war, because of the currency war. It was already under turbulence. And this COVID-19 has brought all the international trade activities to a halt. WTO has predicted that there would be a downfall of around 32%, maximum 32%. But my sense is this figure was given much earlier. And today, when they will come out with this new figure, new percentage, this would be much higher. Even if I talk about India's exports, in the month of March, it fell down by almost 34.5%. And in April, as everything stopped, so the figure would be much, much bigger of the drop. However, I must congratulate the government of India. When the lockdown was declared, the government intervened. They made sure that whatever export orders are there, they get filled. There were logistics problem, there were packaging problem, there were curfew passes issue problem was there. But the government of India stepped in. They made sure that export orders filled and all these activities, they get started. So, sir, very thankful to you. And not only that, if I look at the foreign trade policy, which was ending on 31st March 2020, the government has extended that policy, and whatever other benefits were available under that policy, they have been continued. Thank you very much for that measures being taken by you. I'm happy to inform that 9,759 phytosanitary certificates, digital phytosanitary certificates were issued, which helped in the exports. Similarly, even for import, the government accepted the digital phytosanitary certificates. And on the condition that whenever this lockdown opens, they would make it the physical copy available to the government. In fact, I was just doing Google and I noted that 50,000 tons of wheat has been exported to Afghanistan during this period, and around 40,000 grain has been exported to Lebanon during this period under G2G arrangements. Almost 2,728 import consignments have been released, and government had been proactive to ensure that damage charges, the detention charges, ground rent charges, a lot of staffing problem was there at ports. They ensured that there are the people are available at the ports, at the dry ports, at various other ports. And this lessened a lot of pain of the exporters and importers. Sir, having said that the government has been very proactive, but I would still say that a lot of things still needs to be done to make sure that our industry gets on the same trajectory of growth which the country needs. There is a projection by IMF that India will grow at the rate of 1.9% of the GDP. There is a very recent figures which have come out from Fitch Solution, and they have revised India's projection, India's GDP growth from 4.6% of their earlier projection to 1.8%. And sir, if this growth happens from between 1 to 2%, there would be huge unemployment getting created. There would be huge job cuts, pay cuts. Many of the MSME units will go out of the system. To ensure that we grow at a much higher rate to sustain this kind of employment, we are looking at a stimulus package. If I talk about Germany, if I talk about France, US, Denmark, every country has come out with a stimulus package ranging from 5% to 20% of their GDP. Of course, Indian government has taken some measures. 1.7 lakh crore package was announced by our honorable finance minister for the poor and needy. Liquidity infusion of almost 3.7 lakh crore was done by RBI. The repo rate was reduced by 75 basis points. However, a lot needs to be done. As PhD Chamber of Commerce, we believe at this stage, a 7% of the GDP kind of stimulus package, which comes to around 16 lakh crore, that needs to be given to the industry. And sir, that needs to be announced at the earliest. Every day which passes, it is costing our economy. Every passing day is costing very heavily to the economy. And every delay in the stimulus package is creating uncertainty in the minds of people, in the minds of businesses. To create that confidence, to give them confidence, to boost their confidence, this package of this volume and has to be announced and at the earliest. Sir, rupee has depreciated almost 6 to 7% in last 1.5 months. Because of this, a lot of import orders which were placed, now they have to be, if the payment is made at the current rates, it would be a big burden on the importers. And secondly, for all those basic imported raw materials, where India does not have sufficient production capacity, we would request you to make Indian industries competitive. We would request you to reduce the import duty by 6 to 7%. Similarly, sir, when the activities would reopen, because India is a huge market and the whole globe, if I look at other countries, they are not growing. They are actually contracting. There is a negative growth which would happen as per IMF. So India at even at 1.95% of the as projected by IMF would be the highest GDP growth country. So the world would look at India as a market, and Chinese, we have a fear that China would target Indian market. There would be a lot of influx of Chinese products, and to protect Indian industry, we would request to impose a safeguard duty on all those items where India has sufficient production and where to protect our industry. Sir, this is very important to give boost to our exports, because we believe that when this post-COVID scenario, there would be a big demand disruptions. Not only demand disruption, there would be supply disruption also. So to compensate the domestic demand, we need export market. We need to be competitive in the global economy. We need to be competitive as compared to other countries when it comes to export. So we as Chamber, our research bureau has identified a few costs which needs to be lowered down. The cost, like logistic cost, we are by international standard almost 8 to 10% higher. Our logistic cost has to be brought down. Power cost, the fixed charges being charged from the industry for at least next 6 months, it should not be charged. It should be charged on the actual use basis. The land cost, if India wants to have a number of companies which are right now operating in China, there is a study being done which says almost 300 big factories which are in China, they can move to some other places. If India wants to be home to these places, India has to be a very competitive place. And land cost is going to be one of the important criteria for that. So we have to bring down our land cost. We have to make sure that not only ease of doing, it should be also the cost of doing that should come down. So when I say, I was talking about various costs, even the compliance cost, various compliances are there, which had a cascading effect on the cost of doing business. So compliances have to be made simplified, and compliance cost has to come down. Similarly, the cost of capital, though RBI has reduced repo rate by 75 basis points, and even earlier they reduced repo rate by 135 basis points in last 1 year, but we have seen that only 45 basis points was passed on out of that 135 basis points. And even in these 75 basis points, again, the pass off has not happened. Very little has been passed on. So the cost of capital, the cost of funding has to come down drastically. Sir, we also suggested to the finance ministry, to the commerce ministry, and we would like to also put this suggestion to you. At least for next 2 years, provide tax holiday for all incremental exports. All incremental exports, if assuming 2019-20 to be the base year, whatever is the extra export, there should be a tax holiday which would make Indian industry competitive. Similarly, one of the biggest problem which would be faced by MSME sector and even other industries would be the liquidity issue. A lot of inventory has already piled up, orders have been cancelled. So working capital limit is needed. Higher working capital limits are needed. Even the pre-shipment and post-shipment credit, whatever the due dates were prior to this, this after this COVID happening, they need to be extended by 90 days to 120 days, maybe even 180 days. And sir, there is a need to diversify the export basket, both in terms of products as well as in terms of geographies. Our research bureau has done a study. We have identified which are the areas where India has the strength. We have identified what are the areas where India has the strength, where other countries are also exporting. So there is that study can help the Ministry of External Affairs, the Ministry of Commerce, and we would send that study also. We would request you to encourage those products and give some special concession so that those industries can become competitive. And I'm sure Indian industry would stand, would cooperate. And I, on behalf of PhD Chamber of Commerce, I can assure you that we stand with all the endeavors, all the initiatives which have been taken by the government. We are in 100% with solidarity with the government. We assure you our wholehearted support of PhD Chamber of Commerce, of the members of the PhD Chamber of Commerce, and we'll stand by with you in all your decisions. With this, I close here. I invite you to talk and interact with our members, and I'm sure under your guidance, under your leadership, under your thoughts, our country will bounce back. We will emerge as victorious and we will win this fight. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. President. Honorable Minister, before we hear from you, I will request our Senior Vice President, Mr. Sanjay Agarwalji, to share his views and certain other ideas which Minister Saab can revert later.
I would say our President D.K. Agarwalji has very comprehensively.
Sir, we can't hear.
Sanjay ji, you have been put on mute. Kindly unmute.
Sir, we can't hear you, sir.
Hello. Sanjay ji, can you hear us? We can't hear you.
There is some problem in.
So you can, Naveen, you can invite the Honorable Minister.
Yeah, sir. I think we have Mr. Peter Rimele. Honorable Minister, sir, we have Mr. Peter Rimele, who is the resident representative to India from the CAS. And he will be sharing his views about the global, mainly covering the Germany. So I now request Mr. Peter Rimele to share his views.
Yes, I'm unmuted now. Okay. Mr. Molidaran, Honorable Minister of State of the Minister of External Affairs, distinguished ladies and gentlemen, before I had described a little bit. Can you hear me?
Yeah.
Yes, sir, we can hear you.
Okay, before I had described a little bit the situation from a German perspective, President Agarwal had demanded a stimulus package of the Indian government. And I'm now talking a little bit about what the German government has done. And it is a kind of stimulus package, an extensive package of measures with the overarching goal of being to protect jobs and to support companies. You could even call it a protective shield for employees and companies that the German government is trying to build for its society. And one main goal is to infuse business with sufficient liquidity, a problem President Agarwal has mentioned, so that they would be able to make it through the crisis and, if possible, of course, emerge stronger after that one. All of that in Germany is a matter of dealing with the states. It's not only a decision of federation and with Europe. So I base it on four pillars, what is done there. And one of it maybe is unknown to India, at least it's not practice. We have the situation of so-called short-time working. Of course, in such crisis, there's not enough work there, but you have the employees. And instead of companies going into an agreement to avoid laying off their staff and keep their staff, but reduce the working hours. Now, and the government makes up for the losses partially, and that is because our labor force is mainly in a formal sector. And that is probably not yet transferable to India, where you have 80 or 90% of the labor force in the informal sector. But that would be an argument to maybe speed up after the crisis, the plan, what is there anyway to formalize the Indian labor sector more. So that protects labor a lot and companies. And just last night, the government has agreed on an additional 10 billion euros into a stimulus package, where one part of that is also to finance, to pay more, what is, I think, 80 or 90% of the losses to the labor, to keep them, to keep their competences. Then when a business picks up, they're available and you don't have to start from zero. Another pillar is tax related. You have mentioned that also, President Agarwal. It's the liquidity assistance for business. And in order to improve companies' liquidity situation, the options for deferring tax payments and reducing prepayments will be enhanced and enforcement rules shall be adapted. As a result, business will be able to defer billions of euros in tax payments. The German Minister of Finance has already initiated the necessary coordination process with the federal states. So one pillar. Another one is, of course, and that is probably what you refer to as a part of the stimulus package. Many businesses are suffering either due to disruptions of the supply chain or significant drop in demand in multiple sectors. And even otherwise, financially stable companies are at risk given the financial difficulties and the emerging liquidity crisis. So the government is deciding on one of the most extensive measures ever taken by the German government is therefore protect business with new measures to provide liquidity, and the volume is unlimited. Due to the high degree of uncertainty in the current scenario, the government has very deliberately decided to not set any limits on the volume of these measures, which is a huge relief for the affected business. This is particularly significant decision which is supported by the entire government. And in the first step, existing liquidity assistance programs will be expanded to make it easier for companies to access loans. The fourth pillar I would have to mention here, Germany cannot do that alone. This situation is also a test for, let's really say it, for the survival of the European Union, because Germany is so deep embedded in the European market that whatever it decides, especially in the euro area where you have the common currency, it cannot be done by the German government alone. So this is something, we have a different situation in India, of course. There is no such thing. It can be done on a national level. In Europe, it cannot be done on a national level, and it should not be done on a national level. And the EU will have to prove now that it is capable of keeping euro together. People are even saying a new Marshall Plan. The Marshall Plan, you know, it was after the Second World War, the European Recovery Program. Maybe even the name is justified in this situation after Corona. And if we look at regional disparities, you will have, of course, the southern states, Italy, Spain, and so on, who suffer much more in the economy than the richer and northern states. So probably some kind of more solidarity is expected to share financial burdens. And that is something what is expected of the EU. The EU, to share some criticism, has not performed too well in this crisis so far. From outside, they were discussing, should anything be done, while the Chinese already flew in doctors and medication to Milano, what was mostly hit area in Italy. So this is just a glimpse of the German and the European situation. But the message is more or less the same. Without government getting involved to, on the one side, save labor and the industry, it is not working. So with that one, I thank for your attention and pass back.
Thank you very much, Mr. Rimele, for sharing your views on this. And now, friends, I would request our Honorable Minister to kindly share his views, so that after that we will have the question answer session. Honorable Minister, sir, please.
Senior President of PhD Chamber of Commerce and Industry, Dr. D.K. Agarwal, Senior Vice President, Sri Sanjay Agarwal, Sri Saurabh Sanyal, Secretary General of PhD CCI, Sri Peter Rimele, the Senior Resident Representative of CAS in India, other friends who have joined this video conferencing to discuss the economic impact of COVID-19 and the global supply chain disruptions. Namaskaram to all of you. I appreciate the PhD CCI's initiative in organizing this video conference. I am glad to know that businesses are working to promote our economic interests through these tough times like this pandemic. COVID-19 is shaping to be the first major disruption in the global economy since the 2008 financial crisis. In its scale, magnitude, and outlook, however, analysts have termed it as one which have a far greater impact both on human lives as well as the global economy. International Monetary Fund estimates project that global GDP could suffer by 3% in 2020, and the pandemic will leave more than 170 countries with lower GDP per capita by the end of the year. This could be worsened if this pandemic spills over or witnesses a resurgence in 2021. Let me assure you right at the outset that Government of India has not only been proactive but also preemptive in our strategy of controlling this pandemic. That's why a lockdown has been in force since March 24th, when India was in the early stages of the outbreak. And now, almost after 30 days of the lockdown, the last doubling, yesterday we crossed almost 20,000 cases. And the from 10,000 to 20,000, that doubling took almost more than 8 days. Government of India, while working on effectively controlling the pandemic, is aware and cautious about the economic impacts. Hence, we have transitioned from Jahan to Jaan Hai to Jahan Hai to Jaan Bhi or Jahan Bhi, emphasizing the need to work on all frontiers, especially on livelihood and mitigating the negative economic impact, as well taking advantage of business opportunities brought by the current situation. Our government's relief measures have been focused on protecting the vulnerable section of our population by employing targeted relief measures, including food security and cash transfers. We have also announced measures on working capital support, loan restructuring, and credit term alteration, and stimulus to increase spending power of consumers to assist Indian companies, especially the SMEs. In addition, the Reserve Bank of India has also announced a slew of additional measures to maintain adequate liquidity in system, facilitate bank credit flow, and ease financial stress. To help the domestic exporters, the RBI has also extended the deadline for realization and repatriation period of export proceeds to 15 months from 9 months at present. This will enable exporters to realize their receipts, especially from COVID-19 affected countries, within the extended period, and provide greater flexibility to exporters to negotiate future contracts with buyers abroad. All these measures are expected to provide some relief to the Indian industries and SMEs in these times. It is indeed important that Indian businesses assess the opportunities and take advantage of these measures to not only mitigate the economic hardship brought by the pandemic, but also proactively capitalize on export opportunities, substitute other countries' good in global supply chains, and epitomize the spirit of Make in India, Make for the World. The Honorable Prime Minister of India had observed that in the present times, the need of the hour is to think of business and lifestyle models that were easily adaptable, ensuring that business and commerce can run smoothly, even in the time of a crisis. He also observed that with the right blend of the physical and the virtual, India can emerge as the global nerve center of the complex modern multinational supply chains. This is an important observation that ministries, businesses, and industries must take cognizance of. It's our duty to support the collective global effort to mitigate disruption in global supply chains by increasing supplies of products where we have available capacity, and to ramp up capacity where we can become market leaders. This outbreak has showcased the fragility of the global supply chains, heavily dependent on a single country. This is the time to think of a twofold strategy. One, to build capacity, especially in sectors such as pharmaceuticals, textiles, manufacturing, and electronics, where we could have some relative advantage to the rest of the world. This will help in reducing our over dependence on China for raw material, as well as diversifying global supply chains by offering an alternative to the world. Second, partner with industries and businesses of other countries, both through inward and outward FDI. This will help Indian businesses generate technological expertise where we lack. Line ministries have been working on these lines and stand ready to assist Indian businesses in their strategies for the same. One such opportunity lies in our healthcare sector. India can emerge as the healthcare hub of the world in the near and medium to long term for the development of hospitals, emergency rooms, provision of equipment and supplies like PPEs, ventilators, etc., and training of healthcare professionals. The emphasis on personal hygiene will also see a rise in the demand for hand sanitizers and related supplies, given the impending change in public behavior. This offers an important opportunity for manufacturers to ramp up production of such equipment and supplies to meet the rise in the demand. Government of India has set aside 10,000 crore rupees for shifting the entire manufacturing value chains for pharmaceuticals to India and to boost domestic manufacturing of active pharmaceutical ingredients. The Indian industry will need to pay more attention to the issue of building supply chain resilience, which holds the key for the future. The Digital India Initiative has laid the groundwork and could help in the creation of greater number of e-commerce players in the Indian startup sector, providing greater employment in the logistics and distribution departments for e-commerce players and retailers. In line with the Government of India's vision towards enhanced economic development, the Ministry of External Affairs is already pursuing a multi-pronged effort to improve India's global bilateral trade and regional connectivity. These efforts hold greater importance in the post-pandemic times. MEA will be working with the missions and posts to promote the three T's, trade, tourism, and technology into India. This is also a time that Indian exports can be ramped up. My ministry, in collaboration with the Department of Commerce, as well as our missions and posts abroad, are already in the process of exploring, sourcing, and export opportunities in various countries, and to guide our exporters by putting potential suppliers and buyers in touch with our EPCs and industry, and also facilitate B2B meetings for them. In addition, several connectivity projects are already under implementation, and speedier conclusion of the same will help enhance regional connectivity so as to promote seamless flow of goods and services from India to the neighboring countries. My ministry and other Government of India ministries are working towards facilitating the industry to ensure that India comes economically resilient. Ladies and gentlemen, with a concerted and collaborative approach, we will be able to overcome the pandemic and its worst economic effects. It is time to adapt to the changes and capitalize opportunities which others see as challenges. With these words, let me conclude. And I would also suggest that I have heard the opening remarks of the president, and also the special address, in which some specific points were raised. In fact, some of the points that were raised, since it doesn't come under the purview of the External Affairs Ministry, it won't be proper for me to respond. And I am sure that in the coming days, the Government of India will address many of the issues that have been raised here. In fact, the Prime Minister has already mentioned that at present, the government has come up with a package, as you mentioned, the 1.7 lakh crore package, which is the urgent requirement of the times. Of course, I accept that the packages for the MSMEs and various other sectors have to come at the earliest. Otherwise, as you mentioned, it may not give you the full benefit of those packages. Already the some, I won't say that it is a package, like for example, the refund in the IT payments, the refinancing the MSMEs 50,000 crores through the SIDBI, NABARD and National Housing Bank. All these things have come, but I'm sure that the Finance Ministry and the Commerce Ministry, which are the line ministries who should address, and of course the MSME Ministry, which should address these issues, will also come up with a proper guideline and a proper plan of action for the coming days. With these words, I extend my good wishes to all of you, and let me conclude. Namaskar.
Thank you very much, Honorable Minister, for sharing your views. President sir, you would like to comment certain things.
Thank you, sir, and these were very comforting words that government is already considering the stimulus package. And yes, you are right. As we hear, the package for MSME is on the cards. But when it will come, our request is that it should come at the earliest. But in any case, because we know that a lot of issues which we have raised, if it also goes from your side, it will strengthen our case. So many of the issues which you have raised, we definitely understand that they do not directly come under your purview. But we would still request you to forward from your ministry to the relevant ministry so that they get a better attention and a better follow-up. So that was the request.
Yeah. Honorable Minister, we have from our International Affairs Committee, America's Ms. Rashmi Chopra, she has raised the issue that the repatriation of the Indian students who are there in US, mainly in other countries. So that if some can be expedited, because we have sent letter also that around 500 plus students, which we know we had sent a request. So we would like to have your intervention in that, sir.
I'm aware of this issue, not only from USA, we have students stranded across the globe, right from Caribbean to the to New Zealand and Australia, and not to speak of the UK and Russia, various other countries. MEA is working on that. We are aware of it. Of course, everyone understands the present situation where there is a lockdown. And the spirit of lockdown and the rules of lockdown doesn't allow us to bring anyone to the country and then get them stranded in India at the airports. So we will have to, because there is a travel ban between the states, there is a travel ban between the districts even, many locks, hotspots which are completely locked up. So I'm expecting that up to third, please be patient, and we are definitely concerned about the situation of the not only the students, many who have gone on tourist visas, many who have gone on business visits, all those people who are stranded and stuck up. We definitely are concerned, and we are making our best efforts to bring them back at the earliest.
Thank you very much, sir. Another point was the extension of the F1 visa for the students. So there also we would like to have your views on that, sir.
F1 visa extension.
F1, yeah.
I'll have to check up what is the latest situation. But I'm sure that on these issues, there is a considerate view that is being taken across the globe. All the countries understands the present situation where travel is not easy. So every country is taking a lenient view, and I'm sure that our missions in those countries will also be will be extending our helping hand to everyone who is in an issue.
Sir, we have Mr. Surinder Kalra, who is the co-chairman for one of the International Affairs Committee for Gulf. So he has certain questions. Mr. Kalra, please. Dheeraj, if you can unmute him.
Two questions. One is regarding you also have an apprehension that COVID-19 epidemic may recur in 2021, and other people, even WHO, has said S, and then when went to Europe and other countries, it was virus L. Now the situation is coming that what are the lessons we have learned that it doesn't recur and it doesn't enter our borders again? Spreading internally is a different issue that we can discuss, distancing and other things. Second is regarding, my second question is regarding the export of services. Services normally constitute more than 50% of our GDP. And for those, no borders are required. We can work on internet, we can work and talk to the our overseas. This should help us and revive the export of services from India. Thank you.
I am sure that all of us would understand that this pandemic is going to be a sort of the whole human race is going to be, or the history will be considered as pre-pandemic, pre-COVID or post-COVID. So many things that we are now looking at, the way we look at, is going to change after this whole thing is over. So whether it is services or various other issues that has been raised, on all these issues, how do we face, or how do we come up with ideas that such things don't recur, or how do we minimize the impact of such pandemics? All these things, India has been, if we compare with many other countries, we have been much ahead comparatively with many other countries in all these issues. That is why I said that for a doubling in many of the countries, when in the initial stage in the US and many other countries across the globe, the first 1 lakh, the number of cases came up in around 90 days, and the second lakh came in 11 days. That is, doubling took very, very 1/6 of the first 1 lakh. Whereas in India, from the first 10,000 to the next 20,000, we have progressed a lot. We have made a lot of progress. So these things, it shows the capacity of our health professionals, our health workers, and everybody who are frontline warriors and those who are supporting these efforts. So I am sure that in the coming days, the Indian industry, Indian personnel in various fields, they will definitely come up with new plan of action to face the new challenges that will be coming up.
Thank you. How do we ensure that our international borders don't remain that much porous that such viruses could recur in 2021?
Definitely, that is an issue that every one of us will have to collectively ensure. I am sure that I can assure you that the government of India will not be wanting in its efforts or in its plan on all these issues.
Naveen, I would like to ask one question of the minister.
Yeah, please, sir.
Minister, sir, we know that, as you very rightly said, that the post-COVID world is going to be a very different world. It's going to be a totally a new paradigm. And I think new equations will be built both on geopolitical terms, in terms of commercial relations between the countries, and in terms of strategic relations. And this being your forte and your subject, sir, would you like to give some idea? Of course, we understand that you would not would have certain limitations in being publicly sharing these things, but to some extent, could we get some flavor of what way we should be looking forward to the geopolitical equations turning out post COVID, sir?
See, Of course, post-COVID, how the whole thing turns out, it's an early stage to predict. But still, I would say that the government of India, as I mentioned in my when I made my remarks, the government of India had made a detailed plan, and the External Affairs Ministry had made a detailed plan to launch a website on global mapping of strategic resources. A section of the website is dedicated to a resources platform, which would provide detailed information on world resource endowments and opportunities in three basic areas. One is the mineral resources, second is for opportunities for agri exports, and third is, as it was mentioned, the overseas employment opportunities for our citizens. I will not go into the details of the whole thing. But at the same time, looking at the geopolitical situation, I would say that India has always been propounding that we are for a multilateral world order. So we don't look at the world into one or two lobbies. And India would like to engage with everyone. And definitely, the way that it will be beneficial for both. So it will not be an effort which will benefit someone else. It should benefit India, and of course, it should benefit with whom we are engaging. So the point that we had raised even pre-COVID of a multilateral world order, that multilateral world order will be coming into play. I feel that it is going to come into play in the coming days after the post-COVID situation.
Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you very much, sir. Now, I would request Mr. V.K. Mishra, sir. He is basically representing the food and agri sector. So he has certain views on the exports of that. Viraj, if you can unmute Mr. V.K. Mishra.
Thank you, Mr. Minister, by giving such a nice encouragement to us that all the missions will help us to do the trade support. But the major question, sir, there are two, three which I want to bring in your knowledge. India is a major agri-exporter country, and our agri and food processing exports are mainly to Middle East. Almost 90% export, which is heavily depending upon to export to Middle East. And at present, what is happening, the major pulse producer states are lying in North India. So our distance from North India to seaports is really giving us a big challenge in terms of not only logistic cost, rather so many limitations to us. So that is one challenge which need to be looked upon on everyday basis. A lot of solutions have been done, but in spite of so many instructions, the major shipping lines are not giving us any kind of discount in terms of their containers lying in our factory because of this closed down. So each and every company giving us a big challenge. Number two, this is the time where we can procure the raw material from the farmers. But now what is happening, the B2B mandis, the B2B markets are not operating properly. So in absence of any B2B market, the procurement is not going on. And we have a lot of tension that if we will pass this 45-day cycle, then we may not get the right raw material. And then how we will commit the export commitments in future. And third, the most important point, as our president has already given a host of suggestions, the interest cost is already very high, but Government of India has given a lot of benefit to MSME exporters in terms of interest equalization scheme, where they are allowing 5%. But sir, you must appreciate, we large exporters are also expecting this because we take care of 70 to 75% share of the export. So we also need this at least for 1 year or this shorter challenging time, we need this interest equalization. So these two demands, even your ministry may not be directly involved in this, but this is very important for us. And one another last point from my side, the challenging countries like Iran and Saudi Arabia and Kuwait, which do the government procurement have,
hello,
our missions can really proactively participate in that, and they can deal with their governments to have a bulk orders, and those orders can be looked after by us. So we will be looked after to your ministry to have this kind of support. Thank you very much.
No, that's why I know that you have also mentioned that these two issues raised, it doesn't directly come under the purview of my ministry, but I'm sure that the agricultural ministry, especially after the relaxation has come in from 20th onwards, agricultural ministry has made special efforts to see that the crops, it comes to the B2B mandis, and from there procurement can happen. I'm sure that in the coming days, if it has not happened during the last 4 days, the situation is going to they will definitely improve in the coming days. Regarding the role of the MEA, the PM has already stressed in many of his meetings that our mission should promote the trade other than tourism and technology for India. So Indian businesses, how much trade, what is the improvement in the bilateral trade? How much our products we have been able to export? This aspect our mission should focus upon. This the PM has been specifically stressing upon, and I'm sure that our missions will rise up to the requirement of the time, and the PM's call will be definitely implemented.
Thank you very much, sir. We have taken a lot of your time. Just last one question from Mr. Dinkar Maladi. He will be addressing some questions. Neeraj, if you can just unmute Mr. Dinkar
Maladi.
Could you please vote for Mr. Haldar Roos?
Sir, good evening. I am Dinak, logistics industry.
Yeah, Mr. Maladi.
We can hear you. Please speak.
Sir, this is regarding logistics industry. We are looking forward to the government to provide support in terms of some relief package, because the sector has been helping the overall trade generally in terms of clearing decongestion of the ports, decongestion of airports in terms of CFS and ICDs. But practically, in terms of announcements which have come for the normal general sector, but nothing for the logistics sector, which employs a lot of people and have worked in the middle of the crisis going on in clearances. And the second part is, sir, the recent announcement again from the Home Ministry, where they have asked the logistics sector to support the industry in terms of clearance of ports, but at free of cost. That is, no charging of any damage or any other things. So, given the current scenario, sir, it's a double whammy, no package from government or relief and free service. So, we don't know how the salaries will be paid for the logistics sector employees. Thank you.
No, I understand your issue, and it's part of the situation that we are going through, because the entire economic sector and the industry is facing these challenges. And I'm sure that the respective ministries will take this into consideration. I will definitely pass on this suggestion and the demand that you have raised to the respective ministries.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, sir. Before I invite our senior VP to propose the vote of thanks, I just wanted to inform you that the PhD Chamber has been actively involved in supporting the activities of government. And as the President, sir, also during his press conference has mentioned that through our members, we have contributed roughly around 525 crores to the PM Care Fund. And that has been also acknowledged by the Honorable Prime Minister and tweeted through. So just wanted to inform you on that. I will now request our Senior Vice President, Sri Sanjay Agarwal ji, to propose the vote of thanks.
So let me congratulate the PhD CCI for Thank your you, great effort.
So we are grateful, sir. We are extremely Thank grateful, you, sir. Honorable Minister Boris Dharanji, it's been a privilege for us to interact with you, to listen to you, and to be reassured by you regarding the positive and proactive stance that the Government of India is taking to face this pandemic, this disaster of a worldwide scale, which has never been seen earlier, at least in the living memory of most of the people present in the world. But I think these steps, I think your ministry particularly was definitely the one which should have been or would have been instrumental in being, you know, India becoming the first major country to ban all foreign visas well in advance of any other country. I think that was a very, very huge step, which has played a great role in saving the country from the spread of the epidemic in a very, very timely fashion. And I must congratulate the Ministry of External Affairs for having taken such a bold decision, because there are so many things that one has to consider. But taken on a balance, I think when the MEA took this stance and when the Government of India took this stance, it has done India a great service. And we should always remember this great contribution from your side. Sir, on the practical, on the business side, which we are here to discuss, I think you have given us big clarity in your views and the support that the MEA wishes to provide to the trade and industry. Your vision is very clear. You have identified already the sectors which you need to focus on and where you need to support the Indian trade industry. I think we are very, very grateful for that, sir. Your emphasis on the three T's, trade, tourism, and technology for the country, I think this is absolutely the pinpointed approach that is needed. Your assurance that the embassies, our foreign missions, are going to act not only as our political ambassadors, but also as our trade and commerce ambassadors, is going to be of huge, they should help to the trade and industry. I think this positive approach, once it is taken, because we see many countries in the world, most of the developed countries in the world, we see their embassies and their missions taking a very proactive stance on behalf of the trade and industry in their countries. So if our embassies start doing that on a more aggressive level, on a more day-to-day level, I think it's going to be a huge help, sir. And we would firmly support, very, very strongly support your effort in this. Your clarifications regarding the support that or the balancing again as to how you are planning to bring the students and stranded tourists abroad and on other global subjects is definitely welcome. And I think we have to take a balanced view. But sir, your major point regarding the total change in the orientation of the thinking in the world post-COVID and your stress on there being a multilateral focus rather than being polarization that was earlier prevailing. I think that is something that is a big takeaway for us. And we also have to start thinking in these terms because ultimately trade and industry has to follow the geopolitics. So we are very, very grateful, sir, for your having spared the time for us and to have shared your thoughts with us. And we hope to keep interacting with you. Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you. Thank you. Honorable Minister, before you leave, just one more point. Our Secretary General, Mr. Saurabh Sanyal, has a point to make. So I will request Saurabh ji to please, Dheeraj, please unmute him.
Namaskar, Mantri ji. Good afternoon to you and thank you for a very, very inspiring and motivating talk that you have given to our members. I would like to place a point for the PhD Chamber of Commerce and Industries. As you are aware, sir, that the PhD Chamber was instituted in 1905 and it has covered 100 plus years in
115 years
now in its execution of business and trade and looking after the membership and the advancement of business and trade in the country. When we initially started, it was always as a Punjab, Haryana and Delhi Chamber of Commerce. But later on, we have spread, and after 2010, we have spread our tentacles all over the country. we have our physical presence in 16 states where we have our brick and mortar offices. And in the other 9 states and union territories, balanced union territories, we have our MOU partners through which we execute and help our members and for their business promotion, for their intervention into policy advocacy, etc. However, till now, we are not been allowed to co-host the country heads and the state heads who are coming to our country. And whereas the other 3 apex chambers, the CII, FICCI and ASSOCHAM have been co-hosting it, and the Ministry of External Affairs has always regarded us not as a national chamber, but as a regional chamber. So I would humbly request you that if the co-hosting of the country heads if is included for PhD chamber also, we are ready to sponsor the event along with the other chambers, as we have been the founders and promoters of the ASSOCHAM, the chamber which is ASSOCHAM, which is the Associated Chambers of Commerce.
We are the promoters.
One of the promoters and the founders of that chamber. And yet we are not included in co-hosting these country heads. This will go in a very long way, because our membership of 150,000 members, which basically consists, 70% of them consist of MSMEs, they will have a very big advantage of interacting with the SMEs and CEOs visiting our country along with the country heads. And they'll be able to advance their businesses, they'll be able to collaborate with them, which is, as you are aware, sir, we are a very effective chamber at the states. And the state level interventions will also be, you know, which the overseas companies are looking for. It will be a very big win-win advantage to both of us. So we will send you a letter, Honorable Minister, sir, accept our requirement and get us involved in this co-hosting of the state head, sir.
And Mantriji, just to add this, we are probably the only apex chamber which represents all the sections of the society, like MSME, the medium enterprises, as well as the large enterprises. We have companies like SAIL, Jindal Power as our members. We have MSMEs, micro enterprises also as our members. And we represent all the sectors of the economy. We have 43 expert committees covering 43 sectors of the economy. So that way, you know, we are one of the most representative chamber. So we really request you to include us in the list where we can also co-host various heads of the government.
I will definitely bring it to the attention of our concerned division, who takes care of all these issues, and let us see how this can be, a solution can be found out.
Thank you, sir.
I've been speaking to Honorable Minister, I've been speaking to Mr. Harish, the additional secretary, sir, who's in charge of this, and he has not yet convinced.
So, if what has to go out from you, sir?
Let us see. We'll work out.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Very kind of you, sir.
Thank you very much, and I thank one and all, especially Mr. Peter Rimele, Mr. Pankaj, and Professor Wagner, and CAS for supporting this event. And thank you very much, Honorable Minister, sir, for sparing your time. And we look forward to have more sessions like this with you, sir. Thank you, all the participants. Thank you, President, sir, Senior Vice President. Thank you very much.
Thank you.